Hello everyone, today we are going to see this new model, the specific factor model, which is a little bit different of the Wigardium one, but we are going to see slowly the main differences between the other one and this new one. One of the main differences is going to be in terms of the implication of international trade related to the income distribution. In the previous chapter was like everyone has the same weight, so there wasn't any problem about the income distribution. Here we are going to see that not everyone is going to get the same weight or remuneration. But before of that, we need to set up the main framework, so the assumption of the model. And in that context, we are going to see that one of the important concepts is going to be the production function. In fact, we are going to see that given the production function, now the marginal product of labor is not going to be constant, okay? In fact, we are going to see that this marginal product of labor is going to be determined by one specific concept, which is the diminishing marginal returns. So in that context, with that new marginal product of labor, we are going to draw the PPF curve that is going to be a little bit different to the previous one, to the Wigardium one. And in that context, we are going to see the implication of changes in prices and how it's going to be, again, weights the variable that is going to determine the allocation of labor. And when we set that framework, we are going to make some changes in the relative prices of the goods in one specific economy. And then we are going to open that economy to international trade, but we are going to see that the main changes generated by the new international trade framework is going to be implication in the prices. So because we already know what is going to be the effect of prices, given the previous section, now we are going to see or be able to elaborate the new implications of the international trade. Now we are going to see the main assumption of this model, the specific factor model. We are going to start in a closed context, so that means we just have one economy that we are going to call home, and this home economy is going to be able to produce two kinds of goods. We can say clothes, or also we can use manufacturers, it's going to be the same. And the other good is going to be food, which is the agricultural one. Okay, and for the production, this economy has three possible production factors instead of one, like was the case of the Wigardium model. Now we have three production factors. One of them is labor. For labor, we are going to use the L. The other is capital, we are going to use the K. And finally, we have land, but instead of using L, because it could be confusing, we are going to use T, that is coming from terrain, okay? So three different production factors. Also, we are going to have then two production functions. One for the manufacturing goods or the clothes goods is the same, and the other for the agricultural goods, which is food. We know that the production, the quantity produced in each of them, depends on the production factor that you are using. But we have specific production inputs in each economy, in each industry. In the manufacturing one, we had that for produce this kind of good, we need labor, but also we need capital. And this capital is not going to be in the other industry, while labor is going to be in both of them. So if you want to produce this kind of good, you need both things, labor and capital. Instead, for the production of food, you need labor, but instead of capital, you need land. Okay, so we have capital and land. It's going to be a specific factors for each industry, while labor is the common one in both industries. So we are going to have higher production of this kind of good, as higher is this one, So the relationship is positive. If you introduce more labor in this industry, you're going to get a higher output. Or the same thing in the case of capital. So if you introduce more capital, you're going to get more manufacturers. The same idea is in this case. So as higher is the volume of labor, you're going to be able to produce more food. Or in the case of land, as higher is the volume of land that you're introducing in this industry, you're going to get a higher production. So you already know with this simple formula that globally the output depends on the inputs. So as high as the volume of inputs that you are introducing in each industry, you are going to get a higher output. One interesting thing, as I said, is that this is going to be fixed capital. So it's going to be like a number for us. It's not going to change. Always is going to be the same value. The same thing with land. While labor, so it's going to be constant inside of one economy. So that's mean the number of workers is going to be fixed in each economy. But the thing is, you can have different combination of land, sorry, of labor. Working in one or the other industry. So you can have a number here and a different number here. So it's not going to be like half of the population in one sector, the other half in the other. No, instead of that, you can have many possible combinations. So a small amount of labor here and a high amount of labor here, vice versa. So there are many, many possible combinations. The only thing that we know that is as higher is the volume of labor in one industry, the output is going to be higher. Well, in this context, we are going to assume that perfect competition prevails in all markets. So that means that each production factor is going to be like pay given their marginal productivity. So it's like profits are zero. Now we are going to be the production functions. Here we are going to use just the production function for the manufacturing sector, okay? But the same analysis can be done with the other, with the food sector, okay? So the only difference is going to be that instead of the capital stock, in the other case, you're going to use the land. So remember, it's the T. So what is the thing that we have? We have the production function. And now we're not going to introduce formally that function, just in general terms. So just saying what variables are behind that production function. And we have on one side that this is the quantity of the good that is produced. And here we have the production factors that determine that productivity or that production. We have labor and we have the capital stock of the economy. So this is fixed and this can change because remember that labor is mobile between the two industries. So it can change from one to the other industry, it can move. The thing that we notice, as higher is labor, higher is the production of this good, and higher is capital, higher is going to be as well the production, because production depends on both production factors, okay? Now we are going to draw that production function. Here we have the graph. Here it is the quantity produced in the manufacturing sector. And here we have the labor that is used. The first thing that we saw is that positive relationship between both variables. In fact, we know that as higher is labor, higher is the output, higher is the production. So that's why the slope of this function is positive. You see, if this increase, the other increase as well. If this decrease, the other decrease as well. Okay? Because the thing that we have here are all the outputs, so the quantity produced for each number of labor that you use. We can realize that the relationship is not constant because this is not a line or a straight line. Instead of that, it's like concave, okay? So, and that is going to have a really important implication. We are going to see how is that connection or how is that implication? So here we have our label. This one is zero, so as far away you are from zero is because it's bigger, the number of labels that you are allocating in that industry. So the horizontal is for labor, while the vertical is for the quantity. So quantity is going to be always higher as far away is from the zero, which is here. So a value over here is higher than a value over here or than here, of course. So we see that if the labor is zero, we can say like production is zero. And if you increase labor, given a stock of capital, imagine like 1,000 of machines, if you introduce one labor, that labor is going to be really productive. Zero labors, even in the case that you have many machines, it's not going to produce anything. But if you just increase one unit of labor, we have an output equal to 10, okay? So this is 10. One labor is going to produce 10 manufactured goods. Also, we can draw that in terms of marginal productivity of labor, because marginal productivity of labor is how much produce one labor more. So here we have that graph also. Marginal product of labor related to labor. So if we increase in one unit the labor, like was here, so here we have one worker, the first workers, and we know that the marginal product of this worker is 10. So that's why we have here the 10. So I change the scale to see everything better, okay? So the marginal product of labor is how much is going to produce this labor. The marginal product of labor is going to be how much is going to produce each new worker. So because this is the first one, that is the new workers. So the marginal product of this worker is equal to 10. But let's see what's going on if you introduce more and more and more and more labor over time. So if we introduce 5 units of labor, we are going to have an output of 30 units of manufacturing goods. And if we increase as well as here in just one unit, we can see that instead of 5 labor, we have 6 labor, and the output is not going to increase so much as before. Now, the output of this 6th labor is going to be 31. So that means just it's going to increase the production in 1 unit. So though the relationship between the input, which is labor, and the output, which is the number of goods that is produced in that manufacturing sector, is positive, so more labor is more output, we can see now that it's not always in the same way. Here at the very beginning, one labor, it was really productive, right? Well, now one labor more, in this case, where we have more labor, it's not so productive as before. And we can see that because also the shape of the curve, which is in this way. Just keep in mind, more production is when the value is up, right? The vertical one. But you can see that this is a stop of rising. It's flatter anytime. As higher is the number of labor you have, this slope is flatter and flatter and flatter. So the production increased, but in a small rate. Okay, so we can also now draw the marginal product of labor of these workers, the shift. In fact, we can see that this new worker is producing just one unit, okay, because these 30 units were produced by these 5 workers. But this one, the last one, the marginal one, the last one that is introduced, the new workers, is just introducing one output more in the whole production. So the marginal product of labor for the workers sees is just one. So that's why when we are introducing here labor, the labor sees, the seed one, is just producing one unit. So the marginal product of labor in this case is just one. So here you have the connection of these two graphs. In one half we have the production, even labor. We know that it's positive, more labor is more output, but the relationship is not always in the same way. At the very beginning, the output is really high. We said we have 1,000 machines, one labor is going to produce a lot. If we introduce one labor more, it's going to produce also a lot, because now there are like two people working with all many machines that are capital. If you introduce more and more labor, it's going to be really good, but there's going to be a point in which more labor is not going to produce so much, because you have in mind like as many machines of labor, and if you introduce more labor, that means they have to share the same machine. So that is not so productive as in the case in which one worker has a whole machine for them. So sharing the machine, okay, it's going to produce always more, otherwise you're going to stop getting more people in your industry, but it's not going to be so productive as the beginning. So that means if you want to produce more when you are already producing a lot, so that means when you have already many workers, if you want to produce more, a little bit more, like this, that means that you need a lot of labor, because this labor is not so productive as this labor. The thing is, the number of machines is constant, so the capital is constant, and this new labor is not so productive as the previous one. So that means if you want to increase your production, involves more inputs, and the only input that you can change is labor, so you need a lot of labor, which is not really productive, so you need a lot of labor, and that is going to have a cost in terms of opportunity cost. Because keep in mind that the amount of labor in one economy, the whole economy in this case, is constant. So if you introduce more labor in this manufacturing sector, so the labor of the manufacturing sector increase, that means because the other is decreasing and has a really high cost. Because imagine all these people in the other, if here there are many people, it's because in the other sector there are a few people. So if you introduce even more people here, that means you have even less in the other sector, which is really productive, because when you have a few amount of labor in one industry, that labor is really productive. You need to incorporate more and more to get a higher volume in general. So the cost here is not just the fact that you have to hire a lot of people, which is true, but also is that these people is not really productive in the other economy, in the other industry is really productive. So the opportunity cost is really high, because you are giving up the production of food, of a high or a really high amount of food that is not produced, because that labor is here instead of the other one. Okay, that is one really important implication of this production function. And as I said, this is the marginal product of labor, is another way to see that. While here was the total output given an amount of labor, if we have 5 labors, the total output is 30. This is sort of different, is how much produce each new labor. And we can see that at the very beginning, labor is really productive, so it's really good to incorporate more labor, because the production is really high. But as higher is the amount or the number of workers that you have in one industry, the production of it, of that new labor, of that new workers, is smaller and smaller. So there's going to be a point in which, instead of introducing more labor here, it's better to put labor in the other sector where it's going to be really productive. Okay, so the same analysis that we have done here with the manufacturing goods, you can do it with the food, okay? Well, just to make a comparison with the previous model, in the case of the Ricardian, we didn't have this kind of problem, because the marginal product of labor, it was constant, and it was 1 over the unit labor requirement. It was about this unit labor requirement of technology. So that means a lower unit labor requirement is because the technology is really good, because the unit labor requirement is how many workers you need for produce one unit. So if it's small, it's because your technology is really good. And that means this value is going to be really high. The marginal product of labor is higher, as better is your technology, right? But this is not the case here, because now the marginal product of labor is not going to be constant anymore. In fact, it's going to change. And you can see that, not just looking the shape of this curve or the shape of this curve, you can calculate that value using this formula. Nevertheless, we are not going to use this formula so much. But it's how change the production when you introduce one labor, right? You remember, that is the meaning of this. So it's not a division for you, it's a derivative, and it means it's going to be something here. In this case, it's not going to be a number, it's going to be a function in terms of labor. But the meaning of this is how much is going to change the production, the output, when you introduce one more labor, okay? So that means that this, you can see that this also is the slope of this curve, how this change when you change this one. Also, you can express that in terms of how change the output when it changes labor, is the same thing. Nevertheless, this in more general way, using derivative. And this is the slope of this function, okay? You can see that the slope is not constant. At the very beginning, it's steeper, while at the end, it's flatter, okay? Steeper, flatter, just keep in mind, C is the flattest one, while the other is with the higher slope as possible. So it means like, because this is also the marginal product of labor, at the very beginning this value is really high, the slope, so the marginal product of labor is really high, but then it's going to get smaller, and here for instance it's pretty small, and this is even smaller. So the marginal product of labor, which is also the slope, is really small. So we were talking about a value like this, for instance, okay? Really small, lower than one in this example, okay? As I said, this analysis, you can do it with the other sector. The next step is drawing the PPF, but before that, we need to connect the two production functions and the relation from the labor, which is that result that is mobile between the two sectors. In fact, we know that the total value of labor is going to be the labor of the in the food market or in the food industry plus the labor in the manufacturing one. Here, just to put a number to make things easier, let's say that the total amount of labor in this economy is equal to 10. It's like saying the total number of workers or the total number of work that can be done is like 10. So that means if the whole labor, so here we are going to draw this line, which is a line, where here we have labor in the manufacturing sector, where here is labor in the food sector. So we know that if the total population is working in that industry, so that means that the total labor here in the manufacturing is going to be equal to the total labor, so 10. And the other case is going to be 0. Just keep in mind that here we have the 0, 0 case. Otherwise, if labor is just in this industry, we'll be here in this point. So that means 0 in the case of the manufacturing sector, while 10 in the other one. And between these two extreme cases, we'll have many possible combinations. They can be 5 and 5, or it can be 8 and 2. So that's is the thing that we are observing through this line, all the possible combination, right? So here we have, for instance, the case in which labor is equal to 1 in the manufacturing sector, while it's equal to 9 in the other, the food one. So it's that point. So as that point, we have many other points. Now we are going to connect the production function of the both industry that we have. What we have here is going to be the manufacturing one, while here I put the food one, okay? So this is the traditional way of drawing this kind of graph, where we have here labor, where here is the production of the manufacturing sector. Here I just changed a little bit the variables. Why? Because here I have labor in the case of the food market, so I put here also labor. So it's in a way to connect both graphics, which is okay. If you know the thing that you are doing, you can put the graph that you want. So if here is labor, here is going to be the output, so the production of food. So we are going to connect both market now. We are going to see the relation between both of them, and then in the next step we are going to introduce the PBF curve, which is our goal. So imagine this point that we were saying, when the production input of labor in the manufacturing sector is 1, that means that it's going to be 9 in the other, because we are assuming that we are going to use the whole population or the whole amount of workers. We are going to be in the PPF, and PPF means when you are using your resources, all of them. So here we know, given this production function, that if labor is equal to 1 in the manufacturing sector, the output is going to be 10. We already know the shape is going to be in this way, which means at the beginning is the production is really high. So that's why it grows really fast. Just keep in mind that here in the vertical axis is production. So as higher is the value, is because it's more production. Nevertheless, when the number of labor is really high, now the increase of output is going to be really small. So here we have the output. Also, we can put the marginal product of labor in this of this industry. That was the previous slide. It can be like this. If you remember, it was 1 labor. The production of that labor was 10. So the marginal product of labor in the case of the first workers is 10, but this is going to just decrease as we observe here. So the additional production of each workers is going to decrease as higher is the number of workers that are already in that industry, given the fact that capital, which is the other production factor, is stuck. Okay, now let's see what's going on in the other industry. So we have that in the other industry, the number of labor is 9. It's quite big, the number, given the fact that the whole economy is just 10. So that means, by sure, we are going to have a higher production in that sector, but also we are going to have a lower marginal product of labor in that sector. The thing is, we don't have a space here for the marginal product of labor for this kind of graph for the other industry, but you already know that the shape is going to be the same as this one. So as we expected, because the number of labor in that industry is really high, the production also is going to be really high. Where is the production? Now it's not here, it's here. You can see that production is 30, which is much higher than 10. Of course, because here the amount of labor is really high. You can see that this and this is the same, because here we can get that for low value of labor, the increase of production that now is in the right side, more production goes to the right side, is really high. So for one worker, it's going to be this increase of production. But then with the time, when you are already producing a lot, if you increase one worker, like here, one worker, now the output increase in a really small way, right? So the same idea. Yes, keep in mind that here is like, instead of going up, as higher is the input, the production increase in a lower way, so it's not so high, it's decreasing. And here is the same, but the production is in the horizontal, so that means you are not going to go so fast to the right side. Instead of that, it's just going up. So we can put another case in which now labor is in this market, so in this industry. So a point like this, for instance, imagine that this is 9, means that the total production of this sector is going to be really high, you can put a number, it's really high, but the marginal productivity is going to be small. So imagine that 8 was the number of workers before, so the worker 9 is just adding it a small increase of production. So these 9 workers are going to be over here, for instance, and the production that is adding this worker is really small. So the marginal product of labor is decreasing. In the other case, so that means if this is 9, it's because the other is going to be 1. In total, it has to be 10. So we are going to get, because this is labor, we are going to know what is the output, which is this one, for that input. And it's going to be a number in this place, a number like that, I don't know. It's going to be between 0 and 30, pretty small in this case. So the thing that we are going to get that is here, when you already are producing a lot of this good, so you are using many workers, if you increase in one worker passing from 8 to 9, the marginal productivity of that worker is going to be really small, small value. Nevertheless, this economy is already producing a lot. That means that if you increase from 8 to 9, that involves that in the other industry is going to decrease the input of labor. So that means that the production is going to be smaller than before. Imagine that before it was 2, this was the output, but now it's just 1. Okay, it's coming from 2 to 1. So the production is decreased, and it's a pity because in this case, the productivity of labor is really high. So you can see that this decrease of output in the food sector is higher than the increase of output in the manufacturing sector. And this is going to be the way of connecting both industry throughout the labor. Now we're going to draw the PPF. We already know that labor is going to be the mobile production factor. In the case of the food market, is land the fixed factor of the specific one that is going to be constant and it's going to be just for that industry. While in the case of the manufacturing one, it's going to be capital, it's fixed, so it's not going to change from one to the other sector and it's constant. Labor, instead of that, can move from one industry to the other. Also, we note how is the connection between the input labor and the output in its case. So if we have here labor, so this graph is like the previous one, the only thing that they make is just changes the way that I was showing that. In both cases everything is positive, okay, so forget about negative, this is not negative at all, it's just one way to get all of the graph together at the same time. So the only thing that you need to keep in mind is zero is there for all of the possible cases. So this is the thing that we have before. So it's like if this is labor in the manufacturing sector and we are here, it's because the whole population, the whole number of workers are in that industry, where here is just in the opposite case, and any combination of that is also possible, okay? The thing is, if we are using the whole volume of labor, all the population of the worker, but it can be in a manufacturing sector or it can be in a food sector, but we are going to use all of them, all the time. So if we start like a point from here, we know that the production of manufacturing is going to be here, more or less, okay? It's not perfect. Something like this. Just remember, the way of drawing this graph is really easy. We know that at the beginning labor is really productive because you just have a number of machines, no workers at the very beginning. So the first workers is really productive, the second one is also really productive, so on. But there's going to be a point in which adding just more workers is not a good idea, and just that the output doesn't compensate too much the input that you are introducing, okay? Especially because you can use that input in the other industry where it's going to be more productive. So how is the way of showing or observing that is when labor is small, so labor is here in the horizontal in this case, so it's when we are here, close to the zero case, the output increase a lot. What is the output in the vertical? So more output is in a higher value, okay, up. So that's why at the very beginning, we go really fast up. But then, this rhythm is smaller. And we increase, because the connection is positive always, but now not so much as before. The same thing is with the other case. We have here the labor in this industry, which is food. Here we have the output. So if we start from a zero case, where no one is in the food industry, the output is zero, but when you increase the labor in this case, so that means go down is more labor, because zero is again here. So more labor means more production. Now it's in the horizontal, so that means go to the right side. And at the beginning, you go to the right side really fast. And then you're not going to go so fast. Nevertheless, you're going to go to the right side because the connection of both variables is positive. So that means always that you introduce more labor in this industry, you're going to get more output, okay? The only thing is at the very beginning, you're going to get a lot of output, but then you're not going to get so much output, okay? So if we start from a point like this, is we already know that if everyone is here in that industry, the output of this one is going to be zero. So zero is here. We are not at all in the right side, just here. While in the other, the output is going to be here. So the PPF starts here. Okay, now let's take another point. For instance, this one. So that means that this is labor in this industry. This is the amount of labor in the other one, in the food case. Okay, you can put if you want LF, LM. We know that given this volume of output is someplace like here. Well, in this case, not really good my graph. Sorry for that. It should be a little bit higher to make the difference, okay? It's not really good, I know. Something like that. So I'm going to put this a little bit up. So that was the starting point, and now it's a new case, okay? So the starting point was here, now it's here. But it's not going to be zero, the output of the production of food is going to be in a different place. We know that if this is the labor in the food market, the output is going to be in a place like this. You can see really productive. Just one worker can be, the production is really high. So now we're going to have the new connection of the two outputs. So that means if instead of being here, is here, so we have some workers, well, a lot of workers, because zero is here. We have a lot of workers in the manufacturing sector and a few in the food sector. We are going to have that this is the production in the food sector, while this is the production in the manufacturing sector. So nevertheless, this is really productive. The first workers is really productive, but we have a few workers, one, two, so though they are really productive, the output is going to be small. Still, we need more workers to produce more because the relationship is always positive. So even in this case, each worker, each new worker is not going to be so productive as the previous one, because we have many workers, we are going to produce a lot. So, and this is going to be the result. So that was at the beginning, now it's here. Let's take another point, okay? For instance, here. Something like more balance. We know if this the number of workers in this sector, this is going to be in the other, because the total amount is going to be the total labor. So the output is going to be here, while in the other industry is going to be here. Now let's see the combination of both. You're going to have a point over here, more or less. Okay, more or less. I'm going to take another point. In this case, almost all the workers are in the food sector, while there are a few workers You see the few workers in the manufacturing, the high value of workers in the other, in the food. So the output in this case is going to increase a lot, many workers, while in the other small number of workers, the production is high, but it's not so high as the other one. So we are going to connect both points, more or less, going to be here. So you can take many points, but the main conclusion is that you are going to get a PPF line, which is not going to be a constant slope line. Instead of that, it's going to be something like this. Okay. This should be for the case in which all the workers are here, okay? So it's not perfect, but it should be. Something like that. You see, now it's not a line with a constant slope. Instead of that, it's like decreasing the slope. Well, sorry, increasing. Here is decreasing and here is increasing. It's not constant. And we are going to talk about that more later on. So, but the main thing or the basic idea is that the shape of this curve is coming from this curve. So it's talking about the diminishing marginal returns that we are going to get from the labor in its case. So this is the way of drawing that PPF. Now we are going to analyze that PPF and try to see how this shape is connected with this other curve. Nevertheless, we have showing that graphically. Now we are going to see the PPF and the meaning of the slope of the PPF. So I changed just the variable because in our slide is in this way. So here we have the production of the food, good, and here we have for the case of the manufacturing industry. We see that the relationship in this case is negative. So if you increase one of them, you have to decrease the other one. We know that because the resources are just limited. So in this case, capital is fixed, land is fixed, and also labor is fixed. The only thing is labor can change from one sector to the other. But the thing is, if you want to produce more food, you have to produce less manufacturing goods and vice versa, right? In fact, we can see that now the slope is not constant, like was in the case of the Ricardian model, in which the PPF was just a straight line. Here have a shape, but the meaning of that slope is going to be the same as in the case of the Ricardian model. In that context, the slope, it was the opportunity cost of producing more when you need more of the good that is here. In this case, that good is the manufacturing goods. And here it's going to be the same idea. So the slope of this curve, which is going to be different in each point, is going to be the marginal, sorry, the opportunity cost of producing one manufacturing here. So let's see how is the slope in 3 points, okay? In a point like this, and in a point like this, and in a point like this, okay? We're going to see how the slope is different. But always is going to be the opportunity cost of producing, in this case, one unit of this good, okay? The inverse of the slope is going to be the opportunity cost of producing one unit more of this one, okay? And it's going to be just the opposite. So here, the slope is like a tangent line. Slope is going to be something like that, right? Just keep in mind that the zero slope is something like this, and the opposite is this one, which is the higher slope. This is quite small because it's similar to this one. It's quite flatter. In this case, the slope is not so flat. It's a little bit steeper. And here is the higher one, right? Something like that, more or less, okay? More or less. So we can say then that the opportunity cost of producing one unit more of this good here is smaller than here, and this is smaller than here. Where cost here is the opportunity cost, so that means the production that you are not going to produce of the other goods. In fact, we can do it just taking several points in those places, okay? And we are going to see the opportunity cost. So imagine that we are here. if we produce one unit more of the manufacturing good, we said that, we said that the opportunity cost is small. So that means the amount of the other good that you're not going to produce anymore is small because it's opportunity cost. And in fact, here you have that was the starting point, and now the new output of the other good is this one. And it's true, it's really a small opportunity cost. So if you want to produce one unit more here of this manufacturing good, you need to give up a really, really small amount of the food good, okay? If we are here instead, happen like this, and we want to produce one unit more, so something like this, more or less. That means that you were here at the beginning, and now you're going to produce less of the other good. This difference is higher than this one, right? So now the opportunity cost is higher. And let's see the same thing, but here. So you are like a pony, like this. And you want to produce one unit more, so here, more or less. So the other setup was producing something like that, but now because you want to produce one unit more of the other one, it's like the other is producing almost nothing. This distance is even higher than the other ones. Yeah, so you're observing that as higher is the production of this good, like values like this one, keep in mind that zero is here, when you are already producing a lot of this wood, producing just one unit more has a really high opportunity cost. Instead, when you're producing a small amount of this wood, introduce or produce one unit more, it's going to have a really small opportunity cost. So the opportunity cost is not constant. And the thing that we're observing is that the opportunity cost is going to increase as higher is the amount of good that you're already producing in this sector. But the same thing is going to happen in the other. So if you are already producing a lot of food, if you want to produce one unit more of food, that is going to have a really high opportunity cost. The same of food as in the case of the manufacturing things. What's going on? What is behind of that? Well, we already know what is behind of that. The thing is, when you are already producing a lot, like point like this, it's because you're already using a lot of labor. So capital is fixed, a number of machines is done, but you already have many workers. So if you just want to increase your production in one unit, because each new worker has a really small marginal product of labor, you need many workers. So producing just one unit needs a lot of labor. And it's labor that is coming from the other sector. So if you as a country want to produce one unit more of manufacturing goods, that means you have to give up the production of a lot of food. Because in that case, in that sector, labor was really productive. And now you're not using that labor there. So everything is connected with the marginal product of labor. And the connection of this marginal product of labor, so the productivity of each new workers, is connected with the number of workers is already there in that sector. So we know that as higher is the volume of workers in one industry, the marginal product of labor is going to be smaller. And if this value is really small, then that means that the opportunity cost is really high. So because you are introducing more workers in one sector with a low productivity, and those are workers that you are taking from the other industry with a smaller amount of workers, so they are really productive. You're introducing more inputs with a lower productivity, and you're taking those inputs from the other industry where they are really productive. So you are giving up the production of a lot of food in this case. And the same thing is going to be with the other one, okay? But doing just in this case, you can know the effect of the other. So that's why the opportunity cost is not constant, the slope is not constant. The idea or the main result that we are going to get is here have different to the case of the Ricardian model, it's not going to be efficient just producing one thing. Because always it's going to be interesting use a little, at least a little labor in the other sector where this labor is going to be really productive. Okay? Well, that is the main conclusion of this new PPF, which is completely different to the previous one, in the case of the Ricardian model, in which it was just a mystery line. Well, we already have the PPF, so those are all the possible production combinations. So it's just possibility of production, but we don't know what is going to be the actual production of that economy, in its economy. To answer that question, which is what is going to be the production of in its economy, we need to consider the effect of prices, the effect of wages, and finally the where is going to be allocated the labor, because the labor is the main input in its industry, given the fact that the other, which are specific, are constant. So the total output, the place in the PPF where we are going to be, the production that is going to be the actual production depends on the allocation of labor. So, and that variable is really connected with wages and prices. Why? We're going to see what is behind of the demand of labor. The amount of labor, which is going to be the actual amount of labor in its industry. So we know that the demand of labor is given by that profit maximizing employers, which will going to demand workers until a point in which the value that is producing for its workers, so the value production per labor, is equal to the wage. So, and the value of that production is like saying how much is the production in monetary terms of each worker. So each worker is going to be paid given their production, but in monetary terms. So just keep in mind that you also have the marginal product of labor, which is the production of the last workers. This is not constant, it's going to be decreasing. But the whole, the wage is going to be the same for all workers. And that wage depends on the marginal product of labor. So the production that is new given the new workers, the new worker. That is production, so they are physical units. It's not euros, it's not money. It's number of cars, if we are talking about the manufacturing sector, or number of, I don't know, tomatoes, if we're talking about the food sector. So, but it's a physical thing. But you need to know in monetary terms, so that's why the production is times the price of that good. And that is like the value of production that each worker, well, at least the last one, is introducing in the in that industry. So the demand is going to be reflected by this this expression. So we have wages, which is going to be really important when workers are going to make a decision in regarding to the industry where they want to work, because we are going to assume that workers want to get the maximum wage, which is logic. Also, it's going to be connected with prices. As higher is the price of the good that you are producing as a worker, you are going to get a higher wages. That is good. So if you're producing something really expensive, it's good because you are going to get a higher wage. But also it's connected with the marginal product of labor, so the productivity of workers. So as higher is the productivity, that means that your wage, because you are producing a lot, your wage is going to be higher. So keep in mind that, that connection between wages and the price and the marginal product of labor. And keep in mind that this is the demand, but also in the demand of labor, because the demand of labor is coming from no people, it's coming from the employers, while the supply of labor is us, is our time, so we are the supply of labor. Are we going to assume that me as supply of labor, I'm going to be in the industry with higher wages? So that is going to be a key variable here, a key aspect that we need to consider. to see where is going to be allocated the labor. So it's going to depend on one hand the demand, which depends on prices and marginal products of labor, but also on the supply, which is the people that is going to look the place where they are going to get the higher wage. Well, we've been talking about how is the way that the wage is configured in a general case. Now we are going to see how is going to be the wage in our two industries. So we are going to have the wage in the manufacturing industry and also in the food industry. We already know that the wage is going to be a variable that depends on the marginal product of labor, so that means the productivity of each workers times the price of the good that is produced, in the way that as higher is the price, higher is going to be your wage. So wages are affected by the prices of the good, but also your productivity. If you have a high level of productivity, means that eventually you're going to make more money, we can say. Keep in mind that this is the marginal product of labor, so it's the productivity of the last worker that is incorporated in one industry, in this case in the manufacturing one. So this is also can be seen as the idea that the wage, which is the cost for the employer, the cost of a higher one worker, is going to be like as we are going to give that the value that is the actual value of that marginal product of labor. So we can see that is the value of the marginal production per worker, per the last worker. So it's like the cost has to be equal at least the revenues that is generated by that worker. It's not real, well, yeah, it's sort of revenue of that worker. So we have that. We know also that that is the demand. So a company is going to hire people or demand labor up to the point in which that cost of hire one worker is equal to the revenue produced by that worker. And that is the demand and the supply, because we are going to talk about the PPF. So that means when you are using all the resources or the economy, the total supply is the total amount of labor of the economy, okay? But the demand is the thing that is determined by this way. So we know that workers is the mobile production factor, so that means it can change from one industry to the other freely without any cost. So that is going to determine, or is the is going to give the result that at the end of the day wages are going to be the same in both industry, because if one of the industry has a higher wage than the other, then people is going to the industry with higher wages, because all of us want to get the higher wages that we can get as possible. So this is going to be the condition of equilibrium, and it's going to determine the amount of labor in each industry. How's the way of showing that graphically? Because later on we are going to do it with a formula, but now let's start with a graphic. So we are able to put in the same graph the two demand of labor. So here we have the demand of labor for the case of the manufacturing. So this is the wage. So for each level of wage, we are going to have a different demand of labor. You see, in a way that if the wage is really high, so it's really expensive, that means I'm going to hire as a company a small amount of labor. You see, so here we have the quantity, and here we have the price of the good, that in this case labor production factor, is in the market. So this is the zero value. As far as I'm, the zero value is because the value of the demand is high, okay? So in the right side we have the labor, while in this axis is just wages. So really up is because the wage is really high. And also we are going to introduce the same graph, but flip it in the case of the food industry. So here is going to be the wage for the food industry, and here we are going to have, this is going to be the demand of labor for the case of the food industry. So here is the quantity, while here is the price of the production factor that we are talking about. So we know that the demand is coming from this and this expression, both of them, and it's something like this. You can see that, let's take a look first in the manufacturing sector. We can see that the relationship between wages and labor, the demand of labor, is negative. That means when the price of labor is really high, the demand of labor is small. While if the price of labor is small, the quantity demanded is really high. And that is motivating for this. What is going on here? We already know that the wage is going to be determined by the price of the good. So it's important the price of the thing that you are producing, but also it's going to depend on your marginal products as labor. This is like a number, it can be any, but this is a function, and in fact, it's going to be a decreasing function. Do you remember the marginal product of labor at the very beginning is really high? So that means the first employee is really productive and it's going to produce a lot. That's why I'm able to pay that person a lot. Instead, when I increase in labor, well, the second worker is also really productive, but a little bit less than the previous one, and so on. So we know that this function, this marginal product of labor, is a decreasing function. That's why we're going to solve something like this. Because this curve is the combination of a constant number times a function that is decreasing. And as higher is the volume of people, or number of people that is working in one industry, the marginal one, so that means the new workers, is going to be less productive than the previous one. So that's why it's decreasing. Just check again the graph that we have for this marginal product of labor, and you're going to see this, the same idea. So as I said, wages at the very beginning is really high, but as higher is the number of people that is working in one sector, their productivity is going to decrease, so their wages in that industry is going to decrease. The idea was coming from the fact that capital in this industry or land in the other one is fixed. So imagine in terms of machines, you just have a fixed number of machines. One worker with all the machines are really productive. If you introduce another worker, also is going to be quite productive. But when you have many, 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 many workers, so because the number of machines is fixed, that means all the workers have to share all the machines. So adding more workers is not going to be so productive as the first or second workers. Okay, so that's why the marginal product of each worker is going to decrease. Well, where is the equilibrium here? We said the condition of equilibrium is when both wages are the same. It's in this point, right? Because here we have the same wage in this manufacturing industry and the same in the food industry. So they said, the thing that I said about the manufacturing, of course you have for the other one. It's the same idea. So higher, so a small amount of workers in the food industry means higher wages because these people is really productive. But as higher is the volume of workers in that industry, given the fact that the land is constant, that new people is not so productive, so the marginal productivity of them is decreasing. That's why the wage as well is going to decrease. And as we were saying, here is the equilibrium in which both industries has the same amount of, the same weight. So this is the weight of equilibrium, is the same in both industries. And here we have the number of workers in each industry. So here is zero, and this distance is the number of workers in the manufacturing industry. Well, this distance is going to be the number of workers in the other one, in the food, in this case, and the total is going to be the total labor. So because we are drawing the PPF, so that means when you are using all your resources, here is labor. That's why the total has to be always the total number of workers in one economy. Okay, so perfect. Now we are going to see how is the way, or what is the condition that is going to emerge from this relationship, and how we are going to connect this equilibrium with the actual level of production that was the main question here in this section. Because we were talking about the PPF as all the possible combination of production, but we didn't get an answer about what is going to be the actual production in a closed economy. And we were talking about, well, one of the inputs for each industry was labor, given the fact that the other production factor, it works fixed and they don't change, but this can change. So given that fact, where is going to be allocated this input, labor, and then we are going to see the total output is produced in each industry. Take care that this is going to be one of the determinants of the total production of food, because land is fixed, so that is the number, it's a number, so it's not going to change, but this amount of labor in food market is the one that is going to determine the total production, the actual production. Not the possibility, which is are all the points in the PPF. This is going to be just one point in the PPF. Also, we have the total amount of labor in the case of the manufacturing industry. So we are going to know where is going to be the production of this goods. In the way that if we observe any change in this combination, we should expect also a change in the production of one industry. So, nevertheless, we have been talking about we are going to see what is the point. Actually, we are not going to use an actual PPF curve, function. So, it's going to be just an approximation. Keeping in mind that we know what is going to be the change if we observe a previous change here. So, we are going to see if anything here changes, we are going to have a new result. Given an hypothetical scenario of in which we are going to start, okay? So as I said, it's going to be really important to see where is also the determination, or how is the way of connecting this labor market with the PPF. So now we are going to see how is determined the level of production. As we said, we starting with this condition where the wages in both industries must be the same, which is the same as saying that the marginal product of labor of the manufacturing good or workers times the price of that good must be equal to the marginal product of labor in the food market times the price of that food good. So that means you can relocate these components and you can get this general expression. Okay. Also, in this case, given the fact that we are going to do this kind of graph where manufacturing goods is here, I prefer to give the opposite order, because I know that the slope of this curve is going to be the opportunity cost of this food, and the way of getting that opportunity cost is the slope, and I know that the slope is this in this way. So it's the if I have my manufacturing here, so that means that the opportunity cost of produce one unit more of the manufacturing goods is going to be the minus, of course, because this is negative, marginal product of labor in the food market divided the marginal product of the labor market, marginal product of labor in the manufacturing industry. So I want to connect this slope with this concept and see how this condition, which is an equilibrium condition, is going to determine the production in this PPF. So that's why I'm going to change this. It's just changes the order, but the equation is the same. It's like saying, okay, you can put this, which is multiplying here, put it down, divided, which is this one, and this, which is divided, go here, multiplying, and vice versa with the other things, okay? So we have that. Here is the ratio of prices. In fact, is the relative price of manufacturing goods. Here we have this opportunity cost of producing one good of manufacturing goods. If we put a minus in both sides, the equation is the same. But the interesting thing is here, as I said, we are going to have the slope of the PPF. Okay, now the slope of this PPF is not going to be a number, it's not constant. In fact, it's going to be a function. It's going to depend on the volume of a good that I'm producing of this good or the other good. Okay, or well, it's the combination and how this combination changes. So the opportunity cost, as we said previously, is not constant. But now I know that the equilibrium, so the allocation of labor that are going to determine the final production in each industry, is given by this relationship. So it's going to be a point over the PPF, because it's possible and it's efficient, where the opportunity cost, in this case of producing a manufacturing goods, equal to this relative price of goods, this good which is manufacturing good. So it can be a point, for instance, like this. Okay, so I know it's going to be, this is just a number, okay? This is a function because the slope changes all the time. So it's not just one line, the remaining possible slope here. Well, it's a function, in fact. It's just one slope, but changes because it's a function. While this is just a value, it's the ratio of prices. Okay, so it can be something like this. So while the red line is the PPF, all the possible combinations, this is the actual value of production. So this economy hypothetically is going to have this output in the case of the manufacturing goods. So this is the quantity that is produced in this sector, and here we are going to have the output in the other industry. Okay, so that is the production. And like the Ricardian model, here we can see both lines very well. In the Ricardian case, the thing that we were saving, it was just one line, it was the PPF, but over that PPF was this ratio of prices. Okay, but the problem is because the slope was the same, we couldn't distinguish both lines. Now we are able to see on one side the relative prices and on the other the own PPF. Something that it wasn't possible previously in a closed context in the Ricardian model. We were able to see both lines, but when in that context of the Ricardian model, we opened the economy. But now we can see that even in a closed economy, given the fact that the PPF has a shape that is different to this straight line, okay? That is production. So we already have, what is the production? Remember, production depends on, in this case, capital and also labor in this sector. And labor is determined for this equation. So from here we have to have the amount of labor that is
so going
to be
that was for the case of the manufacturing goods, and the same thing for the others. So because this is also a function of labor, in this case labor in this industry, in the food one, and a land, we use the team.
So now we are connecting how this labor can change given this equation, and then it's going to change the production. So this is the way of estimating production in a closed economy. To get the consumption in a closed economy, it's not going to be the PPF and the relative prices. It's going to be the indifferent curves and the relative price. So we are going to have an indifferent curves, and the slope of this indifferent curves has to meet the relative prices. Okay, so the key here is relative prices going to be common. In the case of, as you remember, we have many possible indifferent curves. Can be one over here, over here. Which one is going to be the one that is going to be connected with the relative price? It's going to be here. We are in a closed economy, so that means that production also is going to be consumption. So in this economy, this is the amount of production of the manufacturing goods, but also at the same time is the consumption of that good. And here we have the case for the food industry. We are going to see that this is not going to be the case when we open to this economy to international trade. In that case, production, it doesn't have to be equal to consumption, because we can produce more of one good in exchange of the other. So finally, we are going to see that the level of production and consumption is not going to be the same one. Okay, but that is for the coming slides.